Of course, the second I start the show, an ad starts, and I'm struggling to open up, locate my tab. The tab location.
Of course,
process.
The second I start the show,
oh,
an ad
double
starts.
Double me. Conception. Welcome to Fox 10 News Now. I apologize for the technical difficulties. I apologize for the sound of the ads, the other YouTube videos you were watching. Let's take a look. I pulled up this video that Steve Krafft recorded for us today. This is him in the Reagan Library, where the debate is currently taking place. What neat access we're getting, thanks to Steve Krafft.
A spectacular setting in Simi Valley, California, the Ronald Reagan Presidential Library. At the entrance to the museum here in the Reagan Library, a statue of Ronald Reagan. The first thing you see in the museum is this portrait of Ronald Reagan. And over here, at the end of this hallway, Ronald and Nancy. Walking right up to the couple, and above them it says, America's best days are yet to come. Our proudest moments are yet to be. Our most glorious achievements are just ahead. Inside the museum, photos of Ronald Reagan's ancestors. An area called Evolution of the Great Communicator.
Actually, a government bureau is the nearest thing to eternal light we'll ever see on this earth.
Clips of Ronald Reagan. His days as governor of California. And then it's on to his time as president. A nation in crisis. Are you better off than you were 4 years ago? His famous campaign line when he ran for re-election in 1984. The presidential lectern. No, that's not the president. A terrible day. The assassination attempt on President Reagan.
I saw Nancy looking down at me. Honey, I said, I forgot to duck. Borrowing Jack Dempsey's line to his wife the night he was beaten by Gene Tunney for the heavyweight championship.
Only in the emergency room is a bullet discovered lodged in his lung.
Looks like a bullet hole here, Bob. This room's cold. Let's get a chest X-ray.
There's a fragment near the heart.
This is cool. This is a replica of the Oval Office when Ronald Reagan was president. Really cool. A lot of history. And some lighter moments. President Reagan practicing his putting stroke. On the phone.
Okay.
With Nancy. With some Boy Scouts. Members of Congress. Some of the clothes worn by Nancy Reagan. If you haven't been here, it's worth the trip.
Well, that was cool. Thank you so much to Steve Krafft for giving us that little inside VIP access. And additionally, I pulled up some of the things the candidates posted on social media prior to going on. This is a video from Dr. Ben Carson.
Hello, friends of the Carson campaign. As you know, we're on our way to California for the debate, and I must say I'm excited about it. It's going to be a tremendous opportunity to really talk about foreign policy, the economy, and general political issues, and I believe there'll be more time to talk about it this time. And I just want to thank everybody for the enormous support. I mean, we are seeing numbers that are just unprecedented in the history of political spectrum in the United States of America, and you're part of that, And I want to thank you because it is our job, we the people, to dictate the direction of our country. And we're the ones who are going to make it happen. Thank you.
So he's always comes off as so kind and soft-spoken. Take a look at Donald Trump. Interesting commentary from him, as always. He says, we'll be heading over to the GOP debate soon. Can you believe CNN is milking it for almost 3 hours? Too long, too many people on stage. I have to agree with him. That is a lot of time for people to stand up on a stage and be on display. It's not like they're Mick Jagger or a rock star that's used to that kind of, I don't know, that kind of just exposure. Let's take a look at some of our packages in regards to the GOP debate too before we move on to other topics like the tsunami. Look at this live video I have as we anticipate the tsunami in Honolulu. So we've got that as well, but let's take a look at some of our political packages and get those out of the way first.
This ABC News Washington Post poll shows that this is shaping up as a neck-and-neck contest between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, but that assumes that they are their party's nominees.
Hillary Clinton attending church in Washington, along with President Clinton and daughter Chelsea, promising to take some political advice from the pastor.
He basically said, you know, if you're going to read and listen to Romans 12, you got to be nicer to the press.
But Clinton's real challenge is coming from voters and from Senator Bernie Sanders. The Vermont Socialist drew a massive crowd of thousands in North Carolina, chipping away at what the Clinton team hopes will be a southern firewall by lighting a spark beneath liberal voters.
I can't find anything that I disagree with in his platform, so I guess I'm kind of a standard poster girl for Bernie Sanders.
And watching all of this from the sidelines is Vice President Joe Biden.
I don't see Biden running unless and until he sees Hillary crashing, though given the data of the last week or so, that could well happen.
All right.
Among Republicans, Donald Trump did something unusual for him. He spent the weekend campaigning, this time in Iowa, and he is solidifying his lead despite attacks from other Republicans, with fellow outsider Ben Carson a strong second.
You know, it's a marathon, it's not a sprint. And that's why we have this elongated process. I think it will serve us well in the end.
And that Washington Post ABC News poll, though, also shows that if you look at the two frontrunners, Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, they are both battling majority perceptions from voters that they are not honest or trustworthy. In Washington, Doug Lusader, Fox News. The second Republican presidential debate is tomorrow, and based on everything we're seeing on the campaign trail, Donald Trump will walk on that stage as the candidate to beat.
Donald Trump supporters in Dallas, willing to brave big crowds and $13 beers, by the way, to bask in this improbable campaign. With Trump firing salvos on illegal immigration, incompetent Washington leadership, and his own rise in the polls.
And now it's time to really start, because this is going to happen, I'm telling you. I'm not going anywhere.
Vermont Socialist Bernie Sanders, meantime, drew his own large crowd last night just outside of Washington in Virginia. That was after appearing at conservative Liberty University, a clear attempt to widen out his appeal with an audience that was polite but staunchly opposed to much of his social agenda.
There are other issues out there that are of enormous consequence to our country and, in fact, to the entire world, that maybe, just maybe, we do not disagree on.
Democratic frontrunner Hillary Clinton says she welcomes the competition from Sanders, but there must be growing concerns for her campaign that Sanders is beginning to peel away potential Clinton voters.
I was a Hillary supporter for so long, but I really like what Bernie says, so, yeah. It's always, I'm struggling right now.
And that really underscores another problem area for Hillary Clinton. A recent poll suggests that she is losing support among women in particular. In Washington, Doug Luzader, Fox News.
When the 11 top-tier GOP presidential candidates take the stage at the Reagan Library in Simi Valley, California tonight, it will be, with more than 4 months to go before the first caucuses, a make-or-break moment for some of them.
As far as most on the line, I think it's definitely Scott Walker. He tried to play it safe in the last debate, disappointed a lot of his fans who were looking for more from him.
While most of the candidates avoided confrontation with frontrunner Donald Trump in the Fox News debate last month, more are saying it's game on in the CNN debate, including the one candidate who did take on Trump in Cleveland.
I think people are all going to wake up and say, oh my goodness, this guy could actually be the commander-in-chief, and I think they're going to think twice about that.
Honestly, Donald Trump says all kinds of things. I don't really worry much about what Donald Trump says, honestly. I'm out there talking with voters every day.
In some national polls, retired neurosurgeon Ben Carson is keeping pace with Trump. A recent CBS News New York Times poll shows Carson just 4 points behind the frontrunner, well within the survey's margin of error.
Dr. Carson, so far, I believe the reason why he's risen in the polls is because he's been Reagan-esque. He's been uplifting.
Donald Trump drew 20,000 last night in Dallas. The latest polls showed Trump ahead, but Ben Carson has surged into the 20s to a virtual tie within the poll's margin of error. Jeb Bush leads all others with just six.
Here's the headline, Carson surging. I say, what about me? Where's my name? I'm at 40. Where's my name? It's unbelievable.
Trump has hit the low 30s. But after tripping up on foreign policy questions since the last debate, Trump rallies tonight on the deck of the USS Iowa in Los Angeles.
I want to make it so strong, so powerful that we never have to use it.
But Trump has not said how, and he's under fire from the fiscally conservative Club for Growth with $1 million ad blitz.
Which presidential candidate supports higher taxes, national health care, and the Wall Street bailout? It's Donald Trump.
This one blasts Trump for backing the Supreme Court decision expanding government power to take private property for public projects.
Trump supports eminent domain abuse because he can make millions.
Neurosurgeon Dr. Ben Carson is getting under Trump's skin, and super PACs backing Carson have now raised more than $20 million, despite Trump's attack on his career in medicine, energy, and faith.
Look at this face.
It was Carly Fiorina's face that Trump focused on recently, as Fiorina boosted her name recognition with Trump's own words. He's been dubbed by several rivals as an egomaniac who's not conservative and has no plans. Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker joined the chorus last night aggressively for the first time.
The more people listen to this, the more they realize this is not our party, this is not the country, this is certainly not the country I grew up in.
Jeb Bush has hit Trump daily for 3 weeks, and the super PAC supporting Bush has now launched a $24 million ad war against the billionaire, contrasting Trump's negativity and pessimism to what they cast as Bush's sunny optimism.
Because I am certain that we can make the decades just ahead the greatest time ever to be alive in this world.
Tomorrow's debate at the Reagan Library will be about a lot more than just Donald Trump. It'll also double as a contest for who among them can best channel the Gipper for maximum political effect. In San Pedro, Carl Cameron, Fox News.
When
Donald Trump drew 20,000 last night.
Well, we know the impact these debates can have, and with 11 candidates packed onto this stage tonight, something's got to give.
It's tough to beat the visual. Donald Trump on the deck of the USS Iowa, just outside of Los Angeles, and talking very generally about national security and preparing to train his own guns on his fellow Republicans tonight.
Because we're doing something special. This is a movement. We're going to make our country great again, believe me.
Trump did have to contend with some nearby protesters who accused him of being a racist. And tonight, he may have to fend off attacks from all sides, from 10 other Republican candidates. And unlike the last GOP debate in Cleveland, the main event at the Reagan Library in Simi Valley will include former HP CEO Carly Fiorina, who's been the subject of Trump attacks but has also fired back. And neurosurgeon Ben Carson will be standing right next to Trump. He's number two in the polls, and he's been closing the gap.
Well, I don't think that my strategy is going to change at all. It's going to be to tell the truth and to talk about, you know, my vision for America.
Maybe Ben Carson is going to surpass Donald Trump. I think that would be a very big deal. If Donald Trump is no longer the king of the hill, seemingly undentable by any attacks or any mistakes or outrageous things that he says.
And tonight, look for challenges from Jeb Bush, who's been increasingly taking on Trump. And for others like Scott Walker, this may be a final chance to make a mark in a still crowded field.
Now, the last GOP presidential debate, the one in Cleveland, was more than a month ago. Since then, just one candidate has dropped out, former Texas Governor Rick Perry. More names could follow, though, in the wake of tonight's debate. In Washington, Doug Luzader, Fox News.
So this is a big deal because it's our strongest indication so far that Clinton's deleted emails could be recovered. The Washington Post is reporting the Denver-based technology company that managed Clinton's private server is saying it has no knowledge of the server ever being wiped clean. But even if it was wiped clean, it appears whoever did not do a very good job. That's according to an intelligence source familiar with the ongoing FBI investigation, who adds those FBI investigators remain confident that they'll be able to recover those deleted emails. Now, you have to keep in mind, there's a big difference between deleting emails and wiping a server. Clinton has repeatedly said that she deleted those emails, but so far, she's refused to say whether or not she actually wiped the server clean. It was a point pressed by our own Ed Henry at a campaign event last month.
You were the official in charge. Did you wipe the server?
What, like with a cloth or something?
I don't know. Well, you know how it works digitally. Did you try to wipe the whole server?
I don't know how it works digitally at all.
Well, now a group of Clinton supporters called Correct the Record has just released a new report which basically says that Clinton's use of a private server while Secretary of State was actually a smart move. They say there's no evidence that Clinton's personal email was hacked, but the U.S. government can't say the same. They're alluding to all those recent cyber attacks on government servers. But it's certainly not clear if Clinton's setup was any safer. In Washington, Kristen Fisher, Fox News.
Fox has learned an aide to former President Bill Clinton checked with the State Department in June 2012 about delivering a paid speech to a group with ties to the Iranian government. The summer of 2012 was a sensitive time for then Secretary of State Hillary Clinton. In July of that year, one of her top aides, Jake Sullivan, started meeting in secret with Iranian diplomats. In the email obtained exclusively by Fox, an aide to Bill Clinton wrote to Sullivan and two other aides to Hillary Clinton, would the U.S. government have any concerns about WJC doing a paid speech for the National Iranian American Council? The NIAC has denied being a lobbying group for Iran, but has called for an end to all U.S. sanctions. The email was obtained by Citizens United and conservative activist David Bossie, who recently shared other emails about the vetting process for speaking requests. Bill Clinton did not deliver those controversial speeches from groups tied to North Korea and Congo, or this one from the NIAC, the former president's office telling Fox Tuesday, as we've said before, as a matter of course, all requests were run by the State Department. And most importantly, ultimately, the president did not give this speech. Hillary Clinton sat for a soft interview with Extra to deal with sliding poll numbers. And let slip, she has contemplated the idea of her husband being her vice president.
And I think the argument would be, as vice president, It would not be possible for him to ever succeed to the position. At least that's what I've been told.
It
has crossed my mind.
While Chelsea Clinton sat with the Today Show.
I love watching my mom read to Charlotte, sing to her.
Her favorite song is The Wheels on the Bus, though the candidate is now trying to keep the wheels from coming off her campaign bus. A new Washington Post ABC News poll found she's lost 29 points among female voters in 8 weeks.
Pay equity for women workers.
Democratic Socialist Senator Bernie Sanders held a huge rally of nearly 4,000 people in Virginia, and women responded.
I was a Hillary supporter for so long, but I really like what Bernie says, so yeah. I'm struggling right now. I'm struggling.
For the people in this crowd, it's unanimous. They love Bernie Sanders. 9,000 people piled into the Greensboro Coliseum Sunday night to hear the Democratic candidate speak.
He's for regular people.
I can't find anything that I disagree with in his platform, so I guess I'm kind of a standard poster girl for Bernie Sanders.
Supporters of the 74-year-old Vermont senator praised his political agenda. Sanders talked about increasing the minimum wage.
Wages in America are just too damn low. The federal minimum wage of $7.25 an hour is a starvation wage.
He suggests raising it to $15 an hour. He talked about better police-community relations.
I want to see police departments in this country look like the communities they are policing.
And also addressed women's rights.
You know what they mean when they talk about family values. And what they mean is that women in this country should not be able to control their own bodies. I disagree.
We need to have conservative principles, not hot rhetoric. And all too often, we heard this rhetoric out of Donald Trump that was very offensive to individuals. We need to be bringing people to the Republican Party who believe that there are principles.
One of the things I thought I'd do, and I'd stress so strongly, the veterans' hospitals, obviously, they have problems. They're not properly run. And when you have to wait long hours and long days, and then in some cases have the doctor say, I'm sorry, I'm going on vacation, believe me, it doesn't get much worse than that. So we're going to create a whole new system. We're going to take the system apart. And if they're not doing the job, the veterans are going to go to private doctors, private hospitals, public hospitals. Right now, and you know it, we have illegal immigrants that are treated better by far than our veterans. It's not going to happen anymore. It's not going to happen. We're going to come out with some plans in a very short time. We're going to be building up our military. We're going to make our military so big and so strong and so great. And it will be so powerful that I don't think we're ever going to have to use it. Nobody's going to mess with us, that I can tell you. Secretary of State Kerry, who maybe, you know, I've been saying Hillary Clinton is the worst Secretary of State in the history of this country, right? All right, I've been saying it. But it's possible the world blew up around her. It blew up, just blew up. The whole world is like a different place. It's possible that because of this deal made by Secretary Kerry, who has absolutely no clue how to negotiate, it may be that he's going to supersede. And I understand that he may want to run for president. He has no chance, like she has no chance. So we're going to see what happens. The problem we have is that the leaders of Mexico, Japan, China, and every other country that we do business with, they're smarter, more cunning, sharper than our leaders. I love free trade. The concept is great, but you need smart people. I have the smartest people in this country lined up. I know the smartest. I have Carl Icahn. I have the best business leaders, and they all want to do it. They're wealthy because they make good deals, like me. I make good deals. With Japan, where their massive ships float right here, and they drop off the cars, right? They drop off thousands and thousands and thousands of cars, millions of cars, and we sell them beef. We sell them beef, and they don't want it. Because their farmers don't want our beef, they protest and they send it back, all right? It's not going to happen that way anymore. You have now found out what illegal immigration is all about, and I am so happy that I'm the one that brought it to the fore, because believe me, it's a big problem. It is a big problem.
A lot of the things that Donald Trump supports and tries to push forward in his campaign directly affect me and my family and my community. So it's important for our voices to be heard.
I represent a lot of people, you know, that come to the States to work. We're not criminals. We're here to, you know, because we came for a dream. You know, we try to reach that dream.
I don't think he's qualified. I don't think he's smart enough. I don't, you know, he's probably the worst candidate out of a not great selection.
I really believe that this is the right candidate who can make this country a way stronger. We are so broke, we got so much debt, and he's saying things straight, black on white. How is it? Immigration problem, military, and all of the other stuff. There's my candidate number one.
Well, I think for sure he definitely has to take care of the vets. And we need a strong military. I believe what he says, if we're strong, and we may not be tested. So I think it's important.
At the American Airlines Center, 20 illegal immigrants that are treated better by far than our veterans. It's not going to happen anymore. It's not going to happen.
You know, it's called Tomorrow Night. So I got here and they asked a couple of days ago, would it be possible? I am with the veterans, 100%. By far, than our veterans. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. So he will never touch, do business with the United States again. We're there, and they're still there, and we don't even ask them. One of them's there because he's a Christian. We have a writer. That he's going to supersede. And I understand that he may want to run for president. He has no chance of cars, millions of cars, and we sell them beef. We sell them
Donald Trump's got a unique platform to run for president. He has declared bankruptcy more often than any major corporation in America in the last 30 years. Think about that. That is a unique way to run for president of the United States, but maybe it makes sense. What is bankruptcy? Bankruptcy is having more debt than you can afford to pay back. Well, that describes Washington. They're always on the verge of bankruptcy. They're always spending more money than we have. Maybe sending the nation's leading expert in bankruptcy is a natural fit for Washington, D.C. That's a unique platform to try to run for president.
You guys are like winning, yet you still have the Trump hat up there. He loves winning. Have you talked to him at all? And do you have any advice for his big debate tonight?
No. I just thought it was a nice keepsake, so it could be a nice piece of memorabilia he's sent me.
He's a guy who likes winning like you. You think he's got what it takes?
I hope so. That would be great. Be a putting green on the White House lawn, I'm sure of that.
Does this seem more of a normal?
This is a Donald Trump designed dress that I found this footage and I had to share with you because obviously it's amazing. But this is a Donald Trump supporter out of Texas who created her own Donald Trump dress, likely to hit the auction block one of these days, especially if he is elected president of the United States. This could hit Christie's any day now. You never know. But I had to pull this for you because I thought it was so silly and fun. And again, this is one of his supporters.
But I want to tell him that I had a lot of interviews with international media, and I stood up for him. He probably needs me with him on the road.
We just want someone that will speak their mind and is not afraid of you know, the establishment and politically correct answers, you know. So we're very excited about what he does.
That Donald Trump is a reflection of deep, deep, deep problems with our culture. Racism, sexism, homophobia, classism.
Donald Trump took the stage to rousing applause from a near full house, then took aim at a host of targets, including Jeb Bush and other Republicans. He reminded the crowd that he is funding his own campaign, not beholden to donors.
I have guys offering me millions and millions of dollars. You know, when you're in number one place, then the bloodsuckers come out.
He seemed to say that he would lower taxes for the working class, but raise them for corporations, especially those who take jobs overseas. But the most prolonged cheers came when he talked about immigration.
We have to stop illegal immigration. We have to do it. We have to build a wall, folks.
Trump said whatever it costs to build a wall on our southern border, $4 billion, $10 billion, he'll convince Mexico to pay for it.
And we will make America great again.
He spoke for more than an hour, clearly unscripted, and when it was over, Donald Trump worked the crowd and the cameras on his way out of the arena.
So there we go. I think that's a nice solid political block. Half an hour political block. Here are live scenes. We're going to have this video hopefully throughout the night. This is the tsunami we're watching, we're anticipating out of Honolulu. I believe at Arizona time, it's supposed to actually hit at 6 a.m. I don't know if I'm allowed to show you this, but I'm getting it in on my satellite, so let's take a peek at it.
Bien, bien, bueno, siempre lo hemos dicho, nunca es oportuno un terremoto, pero, a ver, mire, vamos a revisar...
This is in regards to the earthquake.
Aquí se estaba inaugurando, mire, justo en la Pampilla, así se vivió el terremoto, justo en la inauguración.
So now we've seen that. But we're going to stay on this throughout the evening in case something happens. We will be able to bring that to you live. And we are going to continue. Hopefully John Hook will be back from dinner soon and he can recap some of this GOP debate with us. I'm hearing laughter in the newsroom, which means Donald Trump is probably saying something or has probably said something. Something we've been doing throughout the day here is giving you some of these GOP candidates that are currently on the CNN debate screen, showing you some of their Arizona speeches, because a lot of the most talked about candidates have actually come right through Arizona, which is very interesting. We watched Carly Fiorina, who was in Scottsdale just Friday. Donald Trump, who held a huge rally. Phoenix was one of his first stops, as a matter of fact. And his speeches since have become very theatrical and entertaining. And, oh, wow. I think on that news station I just showed you that they were on live during the earthquake. And, oh, that's scary. I don't know if I'm allowed to show it to you, though. I don't want to get in trouble for showing copywritten material or something. However, I do have Ben Carson's speech here from his time in Arizona. And we will enjoy that while we are on Tsunami Watch.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Well, thank you so much. It is so wonderful to be here with you and to see so many people who love America. And, you know, that's what it's all about. You know, a few years ago, I would have never envisioned me being on this stage at a political rally. And it's not that I didn't care about politics. I actually started becoming engaged when I was 9 years old. I was getting a haircut, and I was looking at television, and I saw these people mowing down people with water hoses and dogs attacking people, and I really started getting very interested in what was going on from that time. But I never really envisioned myself getting into the fray. And people say, you had such a wonderful medical career, why would you now enter the slimy world of politics? And I frequently ask myself that too. But I can tell you the reason why. It's because I operated on 15,000 patients. You saw one of them. And the fact of the matter is, it was an attempt to give them a better life and a quality of life. And you know, I realized that, sure, I could retire and put my feet up and relax and live the rest of my life in luxury, but that would be irresponsible, and I couldn't do it knowing that the lives of so many young people in this country would be in jeopardy if we continued down the same path that we're going down now. And I didn't want to trust that to anybody else. And it wasn't something that I really desired to do, to be honest with you, but I kept being pushed in that direction, and it was wonderful to be able to be pushed in that direction. And I finally just said, Lord, you know, I don't particularly want to do this, but, you know, all the pundits say it's impossible, and they say you can't put together an organization, and you can't raise money because you're not connected with all the big money, so it's impossible, so you really shouldn't even be thinking about it. However, I just said, Lord, if you want me to do it, you open the doors. And if you open the doors, I will walk through them. And, you know, we've been able to put together a magnificent national organization. I found it amusing. a few months ago, the Washington Post says, Carson's organization has fallen apart. All of his people are quitting. This is what they want to happen. It has nothing to do with reality. I just find it amusing. And they said, you'll never be able to raise money. But they forgot about one very important thing, the people. They forgot about the people. And, you know, we have received hundreds of thousands of donations from ordinary people. You know, $30, $40, $50, $60, $70 donations. And I personally am never going to go out and kiss the boots of billionaires and special interest groups. I don't want to do that. Because as far as I'm concerned, there's only one special interest group, and that is the American people. And we, you know, this country was designed for the people, of, for, and by the people. The government was there for one purpose and one purpose only, and that was to facilitate life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness for the people. Now, something has gone terribly awry. And I think one of the clearest manifestations of it was the so-called Affordable Care Act. Because, you know, along comes the government and says, this is what we're doing. We don't care what you, the people, think. We're shoving it down your throat. And if you don't like it, too bad. That's a fundamental change. And you know what? It's the beginning of a big change in America unless we, the people, decide that we're not going to have it. We have to be the ones who make that decision. It is the people who are at the pinnacle. We are the ones at the very top level. We are the ones who make the decision of what kind of nation we're going to have. And if we relax and we become less vigilant, as Thomas Jefferson said, the government would simply grow and grow and infiltrate every aspect of our lives and begin to control who we were, and we would begin to turn into something else. But just before we turned into another form of government, he said the people would wake up and regain control. I think now is the time to do that. Now, you know, America is a land of dreams. And, you know, for me, it was doctor. It was the only thing I ever dreamed about as a youngster. I skipped right over policemen and firemen and went right straight to doctor. And I loved anything that had to do with medicine. I mean, going to the doctor's office was a wonderful thing. I would gladly sacrifice a shot just to smell those alcohol swabs, you know? But you know, it's a land of dreams for so many people. And you know, there are a lot of people who try to denigrate our country, and they try to say that it's an evil place and that we're responsible for all the bad things going on in the world. But have you noticed that there's a lot of people trying to get in here and not too many people trying to escape? Have you noticed that? So I think that says a lot. And you know, that does bring up the immigration issue. You know, the fact of the matter is, we do have an illegal immigration problem in this country. And we have laws, and we need to be able to pay attention to our laws. And what I have said consistently is that we need to seal our borders. But not just the southern border, but the northern border, the Pacific border, the Atlantic border, every border there is. And we can use a whole series of things to do that. not just fences and walls, but electronic surveillance, drones, and many of the techniques that are used to keep people out of top secret places. All of those things are available to us. We have the ability to do it. We just don't have the will to do it. But that will change when we have the right administration in place. And once we get those borders sealed, and you know, the reason that it's so important, a lot of people think it's just because of people coming from south of the border. There are radical global jihadists who want to destroy us and our way of life, and we have to keep them out, and we cannot make it easy for them to get in here. So, you know, this is a matter of our own security that we have to be thinking about. And then once we've gotten those borders sealed, we have to turn off the spigot that dispenses the goodies. There cannot be any goodies for people. If there are no goodies, guess what? They won't come. It won't be worth trying to get through our borders if there are no goodies. And that includes employment. We should make it illegal to employ people in this country who are not legally here. It's as simple as that. And now that will stop the flow. You still have a bunch of people who are still here. Now, some of them, if they can't, you know, meet the employment obligations, will leave. But there are others who are here, many of whom don't have any other place that they can call home. They don't know of any other place. And we, as Americans, have always been compassionate people. I believe it would be reasonable to give them an opportunity to become guest workers. Just guest workers, not citizens, but guest workers. That does not give you the right to vote, that does not make you a citizen, that does not make you eligible for goodies. However, it does allow you to come out from under the shadows. And we need to allow people to come out from under the shadows because they get taken advantage of, and they are fellow human beings, and we do have to recognize that. Now, in order for them to be registered as a guest worker, they have to pay a back tax penalty. They have to pay taxes going forward. And if they want to become U.S. citizens, they have to get in line, in the back of the line, like everybody else, and go through the same process as everybody else. Because we have to pay homage to the people who have done it the right way. And there are a lot of people who have done it the right way. And we should have an open immigration policy, but we should get to choose who we want to become American citizens. That's important. And, you know, the 14th Amendment has been brought up recently about anchor babies, and it doesn't make any sense to me that people can come in here and have a baby, and that baby becomes an American citizen and allows them to come in. That doesn't make any sense at all. You know, there are many countries in the world where they simply have recognized that and don't allow that to occur. I talk about that in a book that will be coming out in October that my wife and I wrote, called A More Perfect Union, which really explains the Constitution and why various things were put in there. Because we all know we have a Constitution, but we actually need to know what's in it. I think that's important. Particularly the people in Washington need to know what's in it, you know? But, you know, I don't think that there are a lot of our problems that we can't solve with a little bit of common sense and a little bit of compassion. Now, you know, one of the questions that someone asked me today from the media, and I'll get to the media in a minute. Actually, I'm going to get to the media now. Because the only business in America that is protected by our Constitution is the press. And the reason that they are protected is because they were supposed to be on the side of the people. They weren't supposed to pick political sides they were supposed to be on. And when they pick sides, they enable the side that they pick to ignore the Constitution and ignore the laws, and they are being disloyal to the nation when they do that. However, they do provide comic relief. You know, I was reading an article from Politico today. You know, they're one of the left-wing organizations. And, you know, they're like digging as much as they can. They go back and try to find a newspaper article from over 20 years ago in which I said, if there was some, if a woman was pregnant and she had a baby with a horrible deformity and her life was in jeopardy, the question was, would I make sure that they got to hear both sides? Because, you know, my side is, you know, I'm very pro-life and I don't want anything done, you know? But of course I would make sure they heard both sides. I mean, that's only reasonable. But they try to take that to say, Carson refers people on to abortionists to take care of them. You know, just total crap, you know, that's what they do. And, you know, they, and then of course, you know, last week they take the thing where, you know, my name is on a research paper because as the surgeon, you know, I take a specimen of abnormal tissue from the brain of a child, submit it to the pathologist, who then compare it with their tissue samples. And they have tissue samples from a one-day-old fertilized egg to people who are 120 years old. And they collect those things in archives. And they compare them. And that's how they make an assessment of where this tissue was likely to have come from. And they take that and they say, yep, Carson's doing abortions, and he's taking tissues from fetuses, and he's doing all these experiments on them. Again, total crap, okay? But their goal, of course, is to try to say that what Planned Parenthood did was okay because I'm doing it. And of course, what they depend on is people not being very informed and therefore being able to be easily manipulated. But I think the American people are going to get very smart and they're going to stop listening to all these silly tales that the press is telling. Now, another area that I think is so important is being informed and being educated. Benjamin Franklin and Thomas Jefferson especially emphasized this. Why were they so concerned about it? They said, our system, our freedom is dependent upon a well-informed populace. And if they ever become other than that, the nature of the country will change. And what did they mean by that? Well, if people are not well informed, then they can be easily misled by slick politicians and dishonest media, and they'd be taken off in another direction very easily. For instance, someone would come along and say, oh, the economy is great. We're doing such a wonderful job. You know, the unemployment rate is down to 5.3%, which is essentially full employment. And if you're not very savvy, you'll say, oh, wow, this is great. You see what a good job they're doing? But if you're savvy and you're informed, then you know that that number can be made to be anything you want it to be based on who you include and who you exclude, and that the real number is the labor force participation rate, which is the number of people who are eligible to work who are actually working, which is at a 37-year low. That's where the economy really is, and of course, that's what you see all around you. You don't have to listen to that. You can open your eyes and see what's going on, you know? But you know, one of the things that concerns me the most is our incredible fiscal irresponsibility. You know, you've all heard about our national debt, $18.5 trillion on the way to $19 trillion. Trillion. I mean, that is a number that's virtually unfathomable. Now, try to put it into context. If you try to pay $18 billion back at a rate of $10 million a day, 365 days a year, it would take you more than 5,000 years. And that's what we are putting on the backs of our young people. And you know, Thomas Jefferson said it's immoral to pass debt on to the next generation. Immoral. I mean, if we could transport him back until today, he would immediately stroke out. I mean, he would say, what are they doing? It is ridiculous. But you know what? That's the good news, because it's actually much worse than that. When you go home tonight, please look up fiscal gap and read about the fiscal gap and read about it from more than one source. You know, I mentioned the fiscal gap in my announcement speech in Detroit in May. What it is the amount of unfunded liabilities that our government owes, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, all the departmental programs, cabinet programs, what we owe going forward versus what we can expect to bring in terms of revenues from taxes and other sources. And if you're responsible, those numbers should be almost identical. You bring that forward into today's dollars and you have what's known as the fiscal gap. Right now it sits at $211 trillion. I mean, it's an unfathomable number. You know, I mentioned that in that speech, and the next day the liberal press came out and say, see, we told you he doesn't know anything. He doesn't know anything about economics. Fiscal gap, what is he talking about? He's an idiot savant. He only knows about neurosurgeon. He doesn't know about anything else. And then the day after that, Forbes came out with an article that said 17 Nobel laureates in economics and 1,200 economics professors agree with Carson. Well, that kind of put an end to that. But the fact of the matter is, the only reason we can sustain that level of debt is because we can print money, which we are doing in an irresponsible way. You know, we decoupled our dollar from anything, from the gold standard in 1971. We can print money based on our good name, our faith and credit. And that could collapse any moment now with the kind of debts that we owe. You know, the ability to print money generally goes with the country that has a currency which is the reserve currency of the world, and it's usually the number one economy in the world, which we were from the 1870s until last year, when China became the number one economy. Would they like to be the reserve currency? You betcha, with the problems they're having right now. But they can't quite sustain it yet. You know, they are working with the Asian International Investment Bank and sinking hundreds of billions of dollars into it along with some of our allies. At some point, they will be healthy enough. But it gives us a grace period. We actually have enough time, if we're smart, to turn this thing around. We can do it. You know, it has been done. For instance, all we have to do to balance the budget is not raise federal spending by one penny for about 3 or 4 straight years. That's all we would have to do. And of course, there's a lot more than that we can do. We need to reduce the size of our government, which is absolutely ridiculous. You know? And all you have to do is not replace federal employees who are retiring. Thousands of them retire every year. Don't replace them. You do that for about 4 years, and all of a sudden you're down to a reasonable level. You can just shift people around. You can also call in all the departmental directors, which I would do, and I would say, cut your budget by 2 to 3%, or you're fired. That's what you do. And you do that for a few consecutive years, and all of a sudden you're starting to cruise, but that's only the beginning. You know, we got to get the most powerful and dynamic economic engine the world has ever known rolling again. We can't do it with all these regulations. We got way too many regulations. And every single regulation that comes out costs us money. And it costs everybody money, and that disproportionately hits the poor. And that's one of the things that's driving the income gap. And you got people like Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton saying the reason we got this income gap is because the rich people have too much money. That is not the reason. You can take every dime of the top 1% and apply it to our debt situation, and we will still be in very big trouble. That is not the problem. The problem is we have to begin to grow the economy and cut things where appropriate and act like people who have half of a brain, you know? We also need to deal with taxes. You know, we have the highest corporate tax rate in the developed world. I mean, and of course that's going to drive people out of here. You know, our Secretary of the Treasury said that American corporations that do business overseas to avoid our high taxes are unpatriotic. Now, that shows he knows nothing about business, nothing about our system. People do not go into business to support the government. They go into business to make money. And a wise government recognizes that and tries to create an environment that is conducive to the development of good business, an environment that encourages entrepreneurial risk-taking and capital investment. That's what gets us where we're going. But right now, let's go back to that, to the capital, to the, what was I talking about? I was talking about the high corporate tax rate. And, you know, what I would advocate is, first of all, lowering it to a level that is below the average of what everybody else is doing, so we begin to attract business, manufacturing, all of those things back into this country. And I would also advocate for a six-month hiatus in corporate taxes so that we could repatriate the over $2 trillion that's overseas, bring it back to this country. What a gigantic stimulus that would be. And it wouldn't cost American taxpayers one penny. That's what we need to do. I would only stipulate that 10% of that money must be used to create jobs for people who are unemployed and on welfare. And the reason that I would do that is because we have to get the corporate sector once again recognizing the responsibility to our fellow man. You know, what we have done in this country is we have allowed the government to do what we, the people, should be doing. And, you know, since the 60s, since the 1960s and the war on poverty, we've spent $19 trillion trying to eradicate poverty. And what have we gotten for it? 10 times more people on food stamps, more poverty, more welfare, more incarceration and crime, broken families, out of wedlock birth. Everything that was supposed to be better is not only worse, it's much worse. And what intelligent people do when something isn't working is they do something else. You know, what stupid people do is more of the same. So we can do better. And what we have to do is encourage business, industry, academia, Wall Street, churches, community groups, everybody to begin to realize that they must invest in our people, particularly in our people who are downtrodden. We only have 330 million people. We're competing against China and India. They have over a billion people. We cannot afford to let any of our people go to waste, and we must work very hard to cultivate all of them. And that's a subject I could talk on for a long time. But also, when I'm talking about individual taxes, we need to fix that system too. Our tax code is 74,000 pages long. It is absolutely absurd, and it can be very simple. As you know, I want a system that's based on biblical principles. You know, because it seems to me that God is pretty fair. Now, I know the progressives think that they're fairer than God is. I know they think that, okay? But the fact of the matter is, his tithing system is based on proportionality. You make $10 billion a year, you pay a billion. You make $10 a year, you pay one. You get the same rights and privileges. How can anything be more fair than that? And no deductions, no exemptions. Now, some people say, but the guy who paid a billion, he's still got $9 billion left. That's not fair. We need to take more of his money. You know what that's called? Socialism, okay? That's not who we are. That's not America. What made America great was not socialism. Instead, it was because we looked at that guy who just put $1 billion in, and we said, wow, he just put $1 billion in. Let's create an even better environment so that next year he can make $20 billion and put $2 billion in. You see? And then On the other end of the spectrum, there are those who say, well, but the guy only made 10 bucks. He can't afford to put a buck in. You know, why can't he? Can he afford to send his kids to public school? Can he drive on the public roads? You know, that is so condescending. Pat him on the head and say, there, there, you poor little thing. There's nothing you can do. You know, I grew up in the bottom rungs of society, and I can tell you that there are a lot of people there who have pride, and they don't want to be treated like that. It's not right. And I think what they would prefer is that we put our efforts into reviving our economy so they can get a good job and climb up the ladder and become part of the fabric of America. That's what we need to be doing. Now, the other thing that I think threatens to destroy us is our unwillingness to take a leadership role on the world stage. You know, we are the pinnacle nation in the world, and there is a responsibility that goes with that. Now, I know that there are some people, and they look back to 2003, and they say, we shouldn't have gotten involved with the war in Iraq, and, you know, we wasted a lot of money and a lot of lives, and it was just a stupid thing, and why would we repeat that? That is a very short-sighted view, because in 2003, our existence was not at stake. And right now, with radical jihadists who wish to destroy us and our way of life, our existence is at stake. It's a different situation. And we need to be smart enough to recognize that. And we have two choices. We can sit around and act like they're no big deal and that they're just a problem for over there. They're not a problem for us. And, you know, we can drop some bombs in the desert. And we can say, you know, we're doing all kinds of stuff. While they continue to grow, they continue to take land from others. And they are even recruiting people from our own country because they look like winners. Or we can say, let's not make them look like winners. Let's empower our military, which is very good, by the way. And let's take the land back from them, including the oil, which I've said for several months now, take the oil, take their source of income, don't let them have anything that even appears like a victory, and wipe them out. And you know what? I'm a peaceful person. I really am. But you know what? It doesn't make any sense to sit around and let somebody wipe you out. That makes no sense whatsoever, and we can do better than that. And in the long run, we actually will save more lives if we extinguish them earlier. The longer we wait, the more infiltrative and the larger they become, the more difficult it will become. And that's something that we should have learned from World War II. I don't know why we are allowing those lessons to escape us. We should know that. Now, we're going to take a few Q&A, but before we do that, I just want to make one more declaration. That declaration is that, yes, I am a Christian, and I do love God. And when you look back at the history of our country, and you look at some of the stories that are well documented, you know that God played an important role in who we are. And even though the president says we're not a Judeo-Christian nation, he doesn't get to decide. We get to decide what kind of nation we are. Thank you very much. Thank you.
I'd like to introduce myself. I'm Candy Carson, and I approve this message.
Okay, who has the first question?
Hi, sir. I just wanted to know what your favorite Bible verse is, and I just want to thank you for being such a loving man of faith and just all the great ideas you have for my generation to come. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. And I'm glad that came from a young person, because I got to tell you, that is the reason that I'm willing to get into this slime pit and do it, is for your generation. But my favorite verse, Proverbs 3:5-6, trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not to your own understanding, and in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Okay. Find someone else.
Dr. Carson, how can we improve education funding in the United States?
How can we improve education funding in the United States? Well, you know, I'm not exactly sure that it's a matter of funding. You know, we put a lot of money into it. And I will tell you that I believe that education is the great divide. It doesn't matter what your background is, your socioeconomic background, you know, your ethnic background, you get a good education, you write your own ticket. There's no question about that. But there are, thank you. There are some issues. And what we have to do is make sure that kids are not stuck in a system that doesn't work. We have to provide school choice. And vouchers, I think, are a good way to do that. I think we also need to use technology in an appropriate way. And this may be a good function for the Department of Education, which needs to be trimmed quite a bit, by the way. They have 4,200 employees with an average annual compensation of $135,000. So we could do better. But after we trim them down, one of the functions is maybe to help spread technology throughout our school systems. There are computer systems that can look at the way a young person might solve 5 algebra problems, and based on how they do it, it knows what they don't know, can go back and tutor them and bring them up to speed, which is the same thing a good algebra teacher can do, but the teacher can only do it for one student at a time. Computer can do it for the whole class, the whole city, you know, the whole state, and we need to take advantage of that. We need to take advantage of virtual classrooms where we can put the very best teachers in front of 1 million students instead of 30 students, taking advantage of technology to allow us to get caught up, because we're way behind, particularly in STEM education. And the other thing I might get the Department of Education to do is monitor our institutions of higher education for extreme political bias, and they get no federal funding if they do it. Anyone, you pick.
Hi, my name is Devontae William Dorsey, incoming freshman at Arizona State University. I, had a question about the new minimum wage and business laws as far as raising minimum wage. How do you feel about that?
Okay, how do I feel about raising the minimum wage? Well, here's what I have said about that. It probably does need to be adjusted. However, there are a lot of factors on both sides. And it's something that we're going to have to get used to as a country. And that is not getting in our respective corners and castigating each other, but being able to sit down, put your reasons, your rationale for your beliefs, and then the other side put their rationales for their beliefs. And we can come up, if we do that, with a reasonable minimum wage that doesn't destroy the job market for other people. We may have to have two wages, one an entry-level wage and one a sustainable wage. But let's have that conversation. Let's make an agreement, and then let's index it to something so that we never have to have this conversation again. That's what I would do.
Hi. I want to ask you about your stand on mandatory vaccinations. Now, I have six kids, and none of them have had any issues, but I have read a lot about kids that have had some death to other serious complications. How do you address that? Because I've noticed on Facebook a lot of moms getting, like, he's lost my vote, and how do you address that?
Okay, you address it with information. You have to be logical when it comes to things like vaccinations. You know, about 20 years ago, there was a lot of information out about vaccinations causing autism. That's been examined by both sides, the pro side and the con side, and no one has been able to demonstrate such a correlation. Having said that, you know, in the Civil War, look at how many people died of smallpox before they discovered how to vaccinate. And we virtually wiped it out. The same thing with polio. There are several deadly diseases that we don't have to deal with anymore because of vaccinations. The number of vaccinations, however, has proliferated tremendously. You know, when I was a kid, it was only a few. Now I think it's like 20. I think maybe we have gotten a little overly exuberant, and I do believe that there is room for discussion when it comes to vaccination, when it comes to things that are non-lethal and things that are not going to be crippling. But we do also have to bear in mind that we live in a society with other people, and it is not fair to just say, I got this disease, but I have a right to have this disease, and I have a right to spread it to you. That is not a reasonable position either. And again, I think it's important to be informed, to sit back and really look at the data closely. But the bottom line is, absolutely, for lethal and very debilitating diseases, there's absolutely no way that people should not be vaccinated against those things if they're going to be amongst other people. But for things that are non-lethal, I think there's room for discussion. Okay, last question.
Ben, first of all, I want to thank you so much when you stood at that prayer breakfast in front of Obama.
Thank you.
And I tell you this, Ben, God's hand was upon you then, and it will remain to be on you. But my question is, sir, with all of this new evidence that we've had from Planned Parenthood and dissecting these babies, Ben, you're a godly man, and can you bring together pastors, and we should be marching in the street. How are we so numbed down that we're not marching in the streets, and what can you do to generate this with the pastors?
Well, there is no question that You know, the videos, the things that we've seen are disgusting, and it demonstrates the depravity that has inhabited our society. There's no question about that. Okay. And I think as people begin to think about this and to digest it, it will have served a very, very useful purpose, bringing that to people's attention. But, you know, I don't have time to lead marches on the streets about it. But you might be able to do that. You know, all of us, however, I do want to leave you with this thought. You know, I do believe that we're going to win the election next year. Okay? And when I say we, I'm talking about people with common sense who love America. That's what I'm talking about. And when we win, what we must do is recognize that we cannot be like people have been in the past and wag our fingers in people's faces and treat them inappropriately. They are still our fellow Americans. We must be kind to them. And we must demonstrate to them what it is to be a real American citizen who believes in the Constitution of the United States. But I have one task for each of you. We have in our country in 2012, 93 million people who didn't vote who could have voted, 30 million evangelicals who didn't vote, and you know a bunch of them. You all have a sphere of influence. You need to convince people that by not voting, they are voting. But they are voting in the wrong direction. And just like in the pre-Revolutionary War days, Americans were tired of King George III and his tyrannical ways, and they started getting together in town halls, and they started talking about what kind of America were they willing to fight for, what were they willing to die for, and they were able to encourage each other, and that's how a ragtag bunch of militiamen defeated the most powerful military force on earth. And you know what? Now the question is with us. What are we willing to fight for? What are we willing to die for? Are we willing to sacrifice for this great nation, which gave us so much and which has so much promise for our children? And I do believe that we are just as courageous as any Americans that preceded us. And if we are willing to pick up the baton of freedom right now and carry it forth, we will truly have one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Thank you.
Incorporarnos a la planificación, seguramente esta cobertura que va a ser extensa. Así que muchísimas gracias y siguen nuestros compañeros. Adelante, Davor.
A Marcelo, que siempre nos acompaña. Y también ya pueden ustedes estar viendo, y se queda, Marcelo Lago, el pobre, aunque dice que no. Y queremos mostrarles ya el despliegue completo de nuestras unidades móviles que se tardaron algunas horas en llegar, pero ya a partir de ahora todo el completo informe de ellos en terreno, que es lo más importante para que usted vea en directo las imágenes.
And we're currently looking at footage of the earthquake that hit, I believe, 150 miles off the coast of Chile. This is some of the video that people inside a grocery store got once the earthquake hit. 8.3 magnitude. We were looking at live footage of the tsunami, or we're looking at live earlier, live feed of the tsunami, or Honolulu, where there is an expected tsunami to hit in just a few hours. But this is currently some footage coming out of Chile in regards to that earthquake, 8.3 magnitude. They continue to play some really scary video, and that's why I cut to this. That's why I cut to this, because they were playing some very scary video of people inside a restaurant and then others inside a hotel. It's amazing the kind of access you can get. I wonder what we're looking at here. It's amazing the kind of footage you can get nowadays, because everybody's got a cell phone and we've all kind of, trained ourselves to quickly pull out our cell phones and document what's going on around us. But this is some news coverage we're getting out of there, and we'll stay on top of this perhaps at a lower volume, but we'll continue to watch this because it is without a doubt interesting and scary stuff. And hopefully I'll get my Honolulu feed back here any minute now. And I can't believe this GOP debate is still happening. I'm exhausted for these candidates. I'm about to change my lower third here in a second, since we've lost our Honolulu feed.
Tonight's debate could lead to more separation between the crowded field of candidates. But how much of an effect do debates like these really have on voters? Our Steve Krafft took a road trip to California ahead of tomorrow's big debate to find out who the people believe is best for our country. And he got some very interesting responses.
Welcome to California. We are on our way to Los Angeles, to Simi Valley, the Ronald Reagan Presidential Library. We're going to be asking people along the way what they think of this crop of candidates, and a certain Donald Trump in particular. And this is the General Patton Museum in Chiriaco Summit, California. This place gets a lot of veterans and all kinds of folks who are very interested in the military and, of course, General Patton. And they're also very interested in the Republican debate. Who do you like?
Well, I like Trump.
Why do you like him?
Well, he tells it like it is, and he's not in it for the money, because he's already got more money than the government does.
Well, now we're surrounded by cars. We're in the San Bernardino area, and we just talked to a guy who kind of likes Ben Carson.
I don't know. He just seems to be a righteous guy, you know, just kind of, you know, what he does is... This is what he says, just seems to be good.
Now we're in Boyle Heights. This is a historic neighborhood in East LA, and we're finding little interest in tomorrow's Republican debate and little support for Donald Trump.
I wouldn't vote for Donald Trump. I don't think he'll be a good president, especially I've been hearing about all the Mexicans he wants to throw out.
So here we are on Rodeo Drive, the world's most expensive outdoor mall, where they have the most expensive everything. So we brought our trusty success by Trump, and we're asking people for their take on the political scene, and we're not getting a lot of takers.
Eyes and hairdos? I mean, come on. There's real issues out there, and we need a real person to start dealing with it, and it's too much showmanship.
Speaking of which, would you like to try some success?
No, hell no.
Okay, our next stop will be Simi Valley, California, about an hour and a half north of here for tomorrow night's second Republican presidential debate. It should be interesting. In Los Angeles, Steve Krafft, Fox 10 News.
Tour tonight.
There's a little bit of everything for everyone in California, right? Steve Krafft will have live coverage from the debate tomorrow night, of course. And will he be wearing Donald Trump's cologne?
You know, he's not a big fan of the smell. And I have to admit, it was at his desk the other day, and I wasn't a huge fan either.
I'm going to have to go smell it and see how I like it. Of course, you can also follow him on Twitter and Facebook. He'll be tweeting from it as well. And we will have a full recap of the debate tomorrow night on Fox 10 News at 9 and 10.
Nosotros tenemos 222 poblados en la comuna de Montepatria, distribuidos en 5 ríos. Esto sucedió en el río Grande, de en el sector de Tulahuén, y obviamente que también tenemos otros anuncios nomás que también deberíamos tener.
A spectacular setting in Simi Valley, California, the Ronald Reagan Presidential Library. At the entrance to the museum here in the Reagan Library, a statue of Ronald Reagan. And the first thing you see in the museum is this portrait of Ronald Reagan. And over here, at the end of this hallway, Ronald and Nancy. Walking right up to the couple, and above them it says, "America's best days are yet to come. Our proudest moments are yet to be. Our most glorious achievements are just ahead." Inside the museum, photos of Ronald Reagan's ancestors, an area called Evolution of the Great Communicator.
Actually, a government bureau is the nearest thing to eternal light we'll ever see on this earth.
Clips of Ronald Reagan, his days as governor of California. And then it's on to his time as president. A nation in crisis. "Are you better off than you were 4 years ago?" His famous campaign line when he ran for re-election in 1984. The presidential lectern. No, that's not the president. A terrible day, the assassination attempt on President Reagan.
I saw Nancy looking down at me. "Honey," I said, "I forgot to duck," borrowing Jack Dempsey's line to his wife the night he was beaten by Gene Tunney for the heavyweight championship.
Only in the emergency room is a bullet discovered lodged in his lung.
"It's like a bullet hole here, Bob. This one's fine.
Well,
let's get a chest X-ray.
There's a fragment, it's near the heart."
This is cool. This is a replica of the Oval Office when Ronald Reagan was president. Really cool. A lot of history. And some lighter moments. President Reagan practicing his putting stroke on the phone.
Okay.
With Nancy. With some Boy Scouts. Members of Congress. Some of the clothes worn by Nancy Reagan. If you haven't been here, it's worth the trip.
Con el terremoto que nos sucedió el año 97.
Ahí, perdón,
Loreto Lagüen, en el que usted nos hacía referencia al comienzo cuando hablábamos de esta joven de 20 años que perdió la vida. Estamos hablando, por lo menos en esta cercanía, ¿cuántas personas más o menos habitan ese lugar? Sabemos que es una zona muy pobre, además.
En el Tallán deben vivir no más allá de 250, 300 personas.
¿Y hasta ahora no ha tenido ninguna posibilidad de tener contacto con ellas?
No hemos podido llegar hasta Tulagüen porque, como le decía yo, las rocas impiden que nosotros pasemos incluso con vehículos pequeños.
¿Y vía comunicación, vía telefónica?
No se han repuesto aún todavía el tema telefónico.
¿Y todos los sectores que estarían más complicados son entre Ovalle y Montepatria, o de Montepatria hacia la cordillera, o de Montepatria al sur hacia Combarbalá? ¿Qué ha podido usted recabar la información sobre los 222 pequeños poblados que pertenecen a la comuna? ¿Cuáles serían las zonas más complejas?
Las más complejas son aquellas zonas que están en la parte alta de la cordillera.
Ya, o sea, de Montepatria, camino hacia Rapel, La Junta, Bocatoma.
Efectivamente, todas esas zonas son las que sufren más debido al desprendimiento de rocas de la ladera de los cerros.
¿Y en qué condiciones? Evidentemente los caminos están cortados, pero ¿qué posibilidades tienen estas personas de comunicarse, los retenes de carabineros, para saber qué pasa con ellos y si hay situaciones de emergencia que hay que ir a atender?
Bueno, estamos en contacto permanentemente con carabineros a través de la radio de ellos. No hemos podido, contactarnos. Y por lo tanto estamos tratando de hacer todo lo humanamente posible por llegar a todos los lugares a poder resolver los problemas que ellos tienen.
Bueno, usted mencionaba además algo importante que quizás algunas personas no lo recuerdan. El año 97 esta zona sufrió un terremoto importante que además hubo mucha destrucción de todo lo que es vivienda de adobe.
I'm currently trying to locate additional live images from Hawaii for us, but they all keep saying please wait while the images load, so I don't know if there's an issue with the cameras because of the weather warning or what's going on, but I am trying to find some additional hi people. Super saying hi to me in the chat room. Hi Super, you're super awesome. I'm trying to find some live cams for us so we can see the water, so we can see any weather rolling in. We're expecting a tsunami and we'd like to watch it happen. We'd like to watch the process. The tsunami that is in direct relation to this Chile earthquake that you can see on the screen. A lot of crazy video. That almost looks like what we consider an ADOT cam on the right side. This looks like cell phone on the left. But I am trying to find us a live stream so that we can watch the water. I was getting one from my Fox National satellite. It all just says, please wait, and it's going in a circle. I'm going to continue to do this.
Sin información actual sobre la cantidad de pequeños poblados hacia la cordillera que están en esa zona de nuestro país y sobre los cuales esperamos poder tener información lo antes posible. Muchas gracias.
Vamos a ir ahora con otra realidad que de hecho fue confirmada por el gobernador marítimo de Valparaíso, Rodrigo Batuone, que señalaba que se habían generado esta noche diferencias de marea importantes en Valparaíso. Él habló de Quintero, incluso dijo Juan Fernández en algún momento alcanzando variaciones que llegaban a los 2 metros y informaba en ese momento que se había generado una salida en forma leve del mar en Concón, pero también en el estero Marga Marga, una situación que obviamente genera problemas en la zona céntrica de Viña del Mar, especialmente a la altura del puente de este estero, donde los usuarios de redes sociales empezaron a compartir informaciones. Bueno, Enzo Poblete en vivo nos entrega ahora mayores antecedentes de lo que ha ocurrido y lo que está pasando en estos momentos con ese estero. ¿Cómo estás, Enzo? Buenas noches.
Hola, muy buenas noches. Efectivamente, cada ciertos minutos, nuevamente el estero Marga Marga, que divide la ciudad Jardín en dos, vuelve a subir lo que es su cota, aumentar su caudal. Esto es debido a que el mar ingresa nuevamente, cambiando el sentido de las aguas sobrepasando lo que es la barra del estero. La situación todavía, como les decía, se mantiene con cierta normalidad. Cuando este fenómeno se produce, nuevamente las autoridades de la Armada, organismos de emergencia, especialmente carabineros, interrumpen lo que es el tránsito de vehículos, algunos pocos que todavía circulan por este sector. Contarles también que, bueno, aún desconocemos la identidad, pero 67 años tendría la única víctima fatal hasta el momento en la región de Valparaíso, que dejó este fuerte movimiento telúrico, que tuvo una réplica que aún se sintió mucho más fuerte. Esta persona habría sufrido un paro cardiorrespiratorio, fue trasladado hasta el hospital Carlos Van Buren de Valparaíso, donde se intentó restablecer sus signos vitales, lamentablemente sin éxito, falleciendo en este centro asistencial. Existe también, como decían ustedes, subidas del mar, específicamente también en el sector de Concón, donde se habría producido
algún daño. I see in the chat room. Well, I see everything in the chat room. I won't acknowledge all of it, but I saw the earth cams. I went there, and let me know if any of you are having trouble getting the stream to work. I'm looking at multiple cams. Unfortunately, there's just like a circle that's happening on the screen, and what I'm trying to do is bring you a live video as we are anticipating the tsunami to hit Honolulu. Unfortunately, because of this Chile earthquake, 8.3 magnitude, we're seeing all of this interesting footage coming from there. Earlier, I don't know if they've shown it yet, but I know in the corner of my screen I was watching earlier, like children on the streets wrapped in blankets. Obviously, their homes were destroyed. So I would love to find a working camera for you. I don't know if it's my computer or what, but I'd like to bring that to you so that we can stay on top of this story. And I am attempting to do that now.
A las zonas de seguridad por precaución.
Claro, lo que ocurre en estos momentos es que muchas de estas personas que ustedes ven que transitan con sus vehículos solicitan a carabineros, a las autoridades de orden y seguridad, el pase básicamente para transitar de vuelta a sus casas, que según señalan se encuentran en áreas que están sobre la cota 30. Esa es la principal razón de por qué ellos sí se están desplazando, pero la verdad es que existe mucho patrullaje preventivo, son bastante estrictos los carabineros en ese sentido, pero bueno, hay conductores que en algunos casos se arriesgan y en otros casos efectivamente se trasladan rumbo a sus puntos de origen, rumbo a sus hogares. Señalar también que, bueno, sí, a ver.
Sí, perdón, es que es bien interesante, muy probablemente la gente que conoce el estero Marga Marga no lo conoce en la realidad que lo estamos viendo ahora y en esta dimensión, ¿no? Sino que más bien lo ha visto de la otra forma, la común, la que se utiliza para estacionamiento y ese tipo de cosas. Por lo tanto, si es posible que nos dimensiones qué representa el tener el estero de esta forma, cuánto podría mantenerse así y cuál es el riesgo, por lo tanto, que conlleva un estero que no tiene agua, ahora cuando se ve, digamos, inundado derechamente producto de la entrada del mar. Además, de una forma, podríamos decir, contra la lógica física, es decir, hacia adentro, cuando uno tiende a pensar que debiera ser al revés, que el estero desemboque en el mar.
Claro que sí, es contra la... Exactamente, es contra la lógica física, está contra su corriente habitual, está bastante más crecido de lo habitual ya. Por la irrupción del mar sobrepasó obviamente la barra del estero, que sirve como mecanismo para controlar y evitar que este tipo de situaciones sucedan. Hasta el momento la crecida del estero sí se ha detectado, pero no existe riesgo de desborde. Las autoridades sí están chequeando permanentemente de que esto no se produzca, dado que perfectamente, sin duda, constituye una situación de riesgo. Tú nombrabas el tema de los estacionamientos. Obviamente, con una situación como esta, ya no existen los estacionamientos. Y va a haber que esperar a qué pasa mañana.
Consuelo. Muchas gracias. Sí, muchas gracias, Enzo. Seguimos en contacto contigo durante esta transmisión. Recordar también que las clases están suspendidas desde Atacama a Puerto Montt. Lo anunció la presidenta Bachelet, que habló desde La Moneda hace algunos minutos.
Eso incluye la región metropolitana. Varias personas preguntaban esto en las redes sociales. Lo incluye y sería bueno recordar que si bien es tradicional que en esta semana de Fiestas Patrias no había clases, como tuvimos la paralización de los profesores, se había suspendido, por lo tanto, estas vacaciones de Fiestas Patrias y solo empezaban las clases mañana, o sea, más bien, digamos, las vacaciones empezaban mañana al mediodía.
Exacto, había colegios, mediodía de clases.
Claro, en los colegios públicos, por lo tanto, había clases en estricto rigor, aunque fuera mediodía, por eso es que se suspende. Había una cierta confusión para quienes están en los colegios particulares pagados. Bueno, en estricto rigor las clases se suspenden. Para todos los establecimientos, las universidades pueden tomar sus decisiones de forma autónoma, las universidades que están en, digamos, las universidades privadas. Cada una lo comunicará. Entiendo que varias, en todo caso, ya habían suspendido también y anticipadamente sus clases.
Vamos a la comuna de Maipú. Estamos en contacto con Carla Parra. En la comuna de Maipú se reporta un hombre fallecido, un adulto mayor, 86, 87 años. Carla, ¿cómo estás? Buenas noches. ¿Hay más antecedentes de la identidad de esta persona y las circunstancias en las que falleció?
Sí, ¿cómo están? Muy buenas noches. Lamentables noticias que contamos desde la comuna de Maipú, donde producto del terremoto falleció Renato Salazar Díaz, un hombre de 86 años, quien padecía un delicado estado de salud. Hace 4 días había sido dado de alta del hospital del Carmen y nos contaban sus familiares que tenía problemas cardíacos.
It's with that spirit before us that we held our bilateral meetings over the last 3 days. And we had a lot to discuss. Events in Africa and the Middle East present us, all of us, but particularly South Africa, which has taken such an important leadership role in these years, they present us with a full plate of challenges. So it helps that we come to the table as partners and as friends. Over the last 3 days, our working groups focused on 3 areas in particular. On regional security, trade and investment, and public health. On security, our countries are united in the desire to see a greater stability and peace throughout Africa. President Zuma and Deputy President Ramaphosa have shown real leadership in helping the parties in Lesotho to break their political deadlock and carry out elections. In South Sudan, the United States and South Africa are both strong supporters of the recent peace agreement, but we also know how fragile that agreement is. The world is watching to see if South Sudan's leaders finally make good on the promises that they have made to put down the guns, allow more assistance to reach their people, and enable the restoration of a functioning political system. South Sudan has a great deal to learn from South Africa's experience with justice and reconciliation. Across the continent, South Africa is a significant contributor to the UN and regional peacekeeping operations, a topic that will be a major focus of attention at the UN General Assembly session in New York later this month. The Foreign Minister and I also discussed our growing economic ties. Each year, more than $20 billion in goods and services flow between our two countries. The number of American companies operating in South Africa has reached 600. Facebook, Google, and Starbucks among them, with a total local employment of more than 100,000 people. So more and more, our partnership is driving shared prosperity in the region, and that's a trend that could really gather added momentum from a recent 10-year extension of the Africa Growth and Opportunity Act. AGOA, as it's called, was based on the idea that trade preferences would make possible a dramatic increase in economic engagement between the United States and countries across Africa, and that this would lead to a host of benefits, new jobs, training programs, incentives for education and innovation, greater opportunities for women, and African economies that ultimately were more economically competitive and diverse. The United States is really pleased that South Africa has seized the opportunity to export high-quality goods, tariff-free, to the United States. And in our discussions today, we talked about the need for improved access for U.S. exports of chicken, beef, and pork in order for South Africa to be able to best benefit fully from AGOA's generous trade preferences. That's the very definition of fair trade that would best serve the interests of all, including South African consumers. We're also moving forward on energy security, and we discussed that this morning, and diversification. South Africa's government deserves credit for promoting renewable sources of energy and seeking to diversify electricity production. And we're proud that the U.S. companies such as First Solar and Sun Edison are leading the change on wind and solar. Thanks to the contracts that they've signed, the United States has become the leading investor in clean energy in South Africa. A third focus of our dialogue concerned public health. Through the President's Emergency Plan for AIDS Relief, or PEPFAR, as it is known, we have invested more than $4.3 billion to fight HIV/AIDS in South Africa. Together, we have saved millions of lives. And in coming years, South Africa will be the first country in the region to fully manage the care and treatment program on its own. That's a significant milestone. This is a vital transformation, but we all understand that our work is really far from finished. In South Africa, young women are four times as likely as men to become infected in HIV. And we know that these infections are preventable. The foreign minister and I agreed that we have to do more to protect women, in part by changing the behavior of men and by empowering women better through healthcare, improved access to schools, and opportunities for economic advancement. Of course, economic, social, and health initiatives don't operate in a vacuum. They are closely related to the quality of governance and the strength of democratic institutions. In the next couple of years, national elections are scheduled in some two dozen African countries. Five are scheduled for this October alone. As a leader on the continent, South Africa has been and can continue to encourage elections that are free and fair and peaceful and held on time. And the United States will echo that message in support of South Africa's efforts. In Africa, as elsewhere, there is a deep hunger for governments that are legitimate, honest, transparent, accountable to their people, and effective. And that is a standard that every country has to set for itself and look for in others. We should have no doubt that progress on democratic governance will lead to gains in every other field about which we share concerns. In summary, the partnership between the United States and South Africa is healthy and active on both government-to-government and people-to-people basis. Going forward, we will continue to do everything we can to strengthen the economic, political, and security bonds that facilitate cooperation between our two great countries. I'm very pleased now to yield the floor to my colleague and friend, Foreign Minister Nkwana Mashabane.
Well, thank you very much, colleague, and yes, Secretary John Kerry, and good afternoon to you, ladies and gentlemen of the media. We've had a very fruitful interaction of our strategic dialogue, which has indeed confirmed very strong bonds of political, economic, and socio-cultural relations between our two countries, based on values and principles that we cherish, that of good governance, of democracy, rule of law, and respect for human rights. We have agreed that we need more and more interaction to strengthen our bilateral relations. We are pleased that as we meet here, economic relations, economic and trade relations have expanded. And I want to agree with Secretary Kerry that indeed more than 600 American companies are operating happily in South Africa and are also complying to the rules and regulations as espoused in our constitution. We've got very strong cooperation in the field of science and technology, which enhances knowledge-based and ICT relations. We are happy with other areas of engagement in public health that includes PEPFAR and education, and we think this will take us a long way. This engagement that comes through health and PEPFAR not only benefits South Africans, but also many other Africans who find themselves in our country. We've also spent time discussing relations on the multilateral forum. South Africa believes, as we do, in the values that our founding father and the first president of South Africa referred to, that we are a multilateralist country. So we look forward to further engagement with other countries as we chair G77 and China to a very, very successful COP21, working together with all other countries, including the US. We are happy that South Africa is back and has been confirmed to be the beneficiary or continue to be the beneficiary of AGOA, and all thanks to the government here and Congress and all other role players on keeping South Africa on AGOA for the next coming 10 years. South Africa, as the most advanced economy, is able to export more than 98% of beneficiated goods and services through this program to the US. We are also pleased that the USA remains the largest foreign direct investment in our country. The working groups have also agreed on establishment of an energy cooperation group, which should also be looking at all areas that Secretary Kerry had referred to. As we speak now here, the Secretary for Commerce, Mr. Marcus Jadot, is currently in South Africa, leading a trade mission of more than 80 US companies interested in trade and investment opportunities in our country, with a mission that is referred to as Trade Wins Africa 2015. We welcome the reestablishment of diplomatic relations between your good self, Secretary Kerry, and our friends in Cuba. That has been long overdue. And we really would want to pledge that we will be standing by to give support so that even the trade embargo is removed. I would want to confirm that we are a country that champions diplomacy of Ubuntu. Ubuntu simply means I am because you are. We champion cooperation and collaboration against competition. This is one of the values we share. We also know that peace, security, and development are intertwined. We know that there's no way South Africans can sleep ease at night if the neighborhood is on fire. So we champion investments, trade, and peace and tranquil, not only for South Africa, but for our neighborhood of SADC, for the East African community, for ECOWAS, for all parts of our continent. We are engaged in many peace initiatives in our region, Lesotho, South Sudan, the DRC, we have our soldiers there, and many other areas. We are looking forward to a debate also as we go to the UN General Assembly, the 70th anniversary of the UN, to check if indeed the world has become more peaceful and secure, or has become more insecure 7 years on after the formation of the UN. I agree with Secretary Kerry that indeed the events in the Middle East prove that the world has never become so insecure. I also agree that military solutions are not the answer, that we cannot solve political problems through military means. The example we have is of Libya, that if we did not choose to do what has taken place in Libya, we wouldn't be having so many Libyans finding themselves, again, as Secretary Kerry said, with Syrians, with Iraqis, with Afghanistans, and many others from those parts. Particularly, as I said, Libyans, Iraqis, Syria, Afghanistan, leaving their homes as migrants to Norway. I watched on television last night that indeed these people are not going back home because there's nothing to go back home to, that they will keep moving because they've got nowhere else to go and they've got nothing to lose. So it says that indeed leaders need to sit up and think clearly that there is no military solution to any political conflict anywhere, be it in Syria or Libya or anywhere else. We all need to put our heads together, and we are happy that you are engaged with Russia to find political solutions to all these challenges, including that of Syria. Syria has so much history that we all had to cherish. The destruction that's going on there, it's not good. As a mother, I know that I wouldn't sleep tight if my kids are not sure of their next meal. We need to make sure that 7 years on, people who are moving, move because they want to. Because at the end, the real victims become women and children. This migration we see, it's not desirable, it's unwarranted, and shouldn't have happened if global leaders would have focused on political solutions to political challenges. We pledge that you will find us ready to work with all peace-loving leaders of the globe to continue engaging and never get tired of re-engagement and more dialogue and more dialogue, so as to avoid the calamities and this forced migration of those levels which we are seeing at the moment. South Africa is a signatory of all UN-related refugee-related migration issues. We have been receiving migrants in South Africa or asylum seekers who get fully integrated in our societies. We do not have camps reserved for people who come from somewhere, because we know the pain of staying in camps during the time when we were fighting for freedom and Madiba was in jail. But at the last AU summit, which we hosted in South Africa, one of the outcomes was, can we please not only focus on accommodating people, but making sure that only those who want to move, move. Those who want to stay home are allowed to do so in peace and tranquility. I really want to take this opportunity once again to say this kind of interactions, this types of dialogue, particularly between two democracies that have values that we share, needs to continue. And I take this opportunity once again to thank you.
Thank you so much.
Our first question today comes from Elise Levitt, CNN.
Thank you. Secretary Kerry, I'd like to follow up on your comments about your discussions with Foreign Minister Lavrov, and that the Russians, you want to work with the Russians on a political transition. We see in recent days there are 6 Russian tanks, 36 armor personnel carriers, other equipment, which can be constituted as a lethal mobile armored force. That does suggest that the Russians are gearing up for some kind of military action. So clearly their actions on the ground belie their comments that they are working towards a political solution. I'm wondering what it says about the relationship with Russia that in three phone calls you still can't get a straight answer from the foreign minister about what the Russians' intention are on the ground, and how do you intend to get the Russians to voice their intentions. Foreign Minister, I'm wondering, I'd like to follow up on your comments suggesting that the migrant crisis would not be as fulsome as it was if global leaders could meet. What do you mean by that? Do you mean that if there was more action on Syria, that you wouldn't see as many Syrian refugees? Or do you mean just, you know, in countries in general, that there should be more leadership around the world? Thank you.
Go ahead.
Well, I watched, there's nothing much to watch. CNN is one news agency that one has access to in the hotel where I stay. So I've heard on CNN, or watched on CNN, a comment made by President al-Bashar that he will be ready to step down if Syrians say so, and that if it's done through a political process. Standing here, I do not know of any military intervention that has brought about political solutions of the problems. I started with Libya because we were in the Security Council and coming in as a non-permanent member for the second time. We took a resolution, popularly known as Resolution 2033, that particularly for issues of peace and security on our continent, would want the African Union to have the first bite. That did not happen. Bombardment of Libya happened, and what we do have at the moment is there's no, as much as we recognize one sector of that which referred to as government, reality is Libya is in turmoil and risks becoming a failed state. So if indeed that which you are referring to in Syria, of other countries wanting to come in with tankers and other things, it means that the end is not near if, in particular, Russia, the USA, who are members, permanent members of the Security Council, are not talking more and more political solutions. We will not see the end to this. But I am encouraged by the fact that Secretary Kerry says they are having discussions with his Russian counterpart, Minister Lavrov. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, Lisa, I think that foundation of your question actually is incorrect. I don't know where you got the idea that I didn't get a straight answer. I never suggested that. I didn't say that. I've had three conversations, and I've had a number of very direct answers. The question is, are the actions of the Russians going forward going to keep faith with those answers? And is there a process in place? Well, no. It depends what you mean by a straight answer. A straight answer is they say specifically that they are focused on ISIL and that they're going in to do that. Now, obviously, there are serious questions about that. I'm not taking that at face value because we look at the type of airplanes or the type of munitions and so forth, and it obviously raises much more serious questions about what is happening. But the Russians proposed in the conversation I had today and the last conversation specifically that we have military-to-military conversation and meeting in order to discuss the issue of precisely what will be done to deconflict with respect to any potential risks that might be run and to have a complete and clear understanding as to the road ahead and what the intentions are. So words will not
answer all of the questions here. It's actions. And it's what will be determined going forward in very specific ways, but you have to have a conversation in order to be able to do that. And it is vital to avoid misunderstandings, miscalculations, not to put ourselves in a predicament where we're supposing something and the supposition is wrong. So I think you have to, in this kind of situation, make sure that you're dealing with reality, and that's only going to happen through the kinds of discussions that have been proposed. So we are currently evaluating. The White House, the Defense Department, the State Department are discussing the next steps in order to determine the best way forward in order to have a clarity about this road ahead. It is also true that if Russia is only focused on ISIL, and if there is a capacity for cooperation, as I discussed a moment ago, that there still is a way forward to try to get to a political negotiation and outcome. And in the conduct of great nations, particularly nations with enormous power, it is important to make sure you thoroughly explore those possibilities and don't come to a rash conclusion that's based on erroneous judgment. So we're going to do that, and we're proceeding down the road to make to fully understand and to make clear our concerns and our limits. I might add that one of the conversations I had this morning was with Prime Minister Netanyahu. I think it is public knowledge that he has announced he's traveling to Moscow. He will be having a discussion directly with President Putin in order to underscore the concerns that Israel shares, that we share, that other countries in the region share, about not mistakenly winding up actually making things worse rather than better, and attracting more terrorists rather than defeating terrorists. So all of these concerns need to be thoroughly discussed, as they will be in the days ahead. And I'm confident that there still is a path here for a diplomatic solution. And I think, given the fact that everybody says there is no military solution, and given the fact that everybody says they are committed to a political resolution, the challenge now is to make good on those statements. And that's what I will be exploring with my counterparts in Europe this weekend and every day in the work that we do here in the State Department.
The next question is from Kate Fisher, CCTV.
Hello, thank you. Two U.S. senators have just written to President Zuma.
Can you
put it? Hello? Hello?
Yeah,
sorry.
Thank you.
Two U.S. senators have just written to President Zuma to ask him to resolve the remaining issues that are blocking U.S. poultry exports into South Africa.
I don't know if you're having as much trouble. I
have the same trouble.
Yeah.
I can't.
Could we?
So like that? Sorry. Hello. Is that better?
Much better.
Two U.S. senators have just written to President Zuma to ask him to resolve the remaining issues that are blocking U.S. poultry exports into South Africa. Can you reassure him that will happen before the end of the year, which was what was agreed in the agreement that was struck in Paris earlier this summer?
Well, if you're referring to the same letters that I know of, one of them came from Senator Kuhn.
Exactly them.
Yes. We responded to that through our negotiators of AGOA between the two governments. And the conclusion came, that which we are now referring to, after all concerned groups' issues have been taken into consideration, including that of South Africans, not just of the senator this side, because this is about partnership. So where we are now, we know that there was a meeting about a day ago in South Africa, and I've seen the minutes which are taking us forward. and the 65,000 tonnage of chicken portions, boned chicken portions, that were to be exported to South Africa has already also been attended to and agreed to.
So they will be allowed in before the end of the year?
It's a done deal.
Can I just mention, from our point of view, this is the cornerstone of our trade relationship, and we believe very, very strongly in AGOA. As everybody knows, the current bill that passed the Senate for the renewal of it includes a review of the South Africa eligibility issue, and the House of Representatives, we're waiting for action from them. We have had a discussion about how important it is for South Africa itself to define the future road by responding to the concerns that have been expressed about U.S. exports. I'm confident the minister, as she said, is committed to that, and so we hope to proceed forward very smoothly.
I just thought maybe I should have emphasized that I agree with Secretary Kerry that ISIL is an enemy of all peace-loving democracies in the world, be it in the Middle East, U.S., or Africa. Extremism of any sort that which even wishes to remarcate countries need to be fought with all we have. But above all, we need to win the hearts and minds of our people not to join these extremist groups. So there we speak with one voice.
The next question will be from Brad Kleiber from the Associated Press.
Yes, thank you. I have a question for both of you as well. First, Madam Foreign Minister, picking up on your comments on Libya, can I just ask you straight out, do you think it was wrong for Western and Arab countries to have intervened militarily and overthrown Muammar Gaddafi's regime? And also, since you stress that political solutions are necessary in all disputes, or so it seemed, could I elicit your views on how you think a political solution might work with the Islamic State or Boko Haram, for example? Mr. Secretary, given the threat of a new nuclear, North Korean rocket and nuclear tests, how do you engage Pyongyang at a time when you are also warning Iran of severe consequences if it violates its nuclear commitments? Can you do outreach to North Korea right now without also sending a message to Tehran that breaking nuclear agreements and developing atomic bombs wouldn't, in fact, prompt devastating consequences, but will yield more diplomacy instead?
Well, let me start with Libya. We all had a discussion, as I said. We were serving as non-permanent member of the Security Council at that time, and that the African Union presented a roadmap, an AU roadmap to a political solution to Libya. And the arrangement thereof was also about how the late Gaddafi was prepared to step aside at that time for them to form a government of national unity. I think the interpretation of responsibility to protect civilians brought about that which is now history. And I don't think there was a clear plan that beyond that, what is it that was going to come in and take place? And it's almost more than 5 or 6 years since, and Libya is still a mess. So we believe that should we have followed the AU roadmap, which was very much part of Resolution 1973, that which we also supported and adopted, maybe things would have been different. This is not the time for blame game, but it's the time to say, what do we do now? Because Libyans just want to carry on with their lives, and they want a stable government that would unite them. I do not see the comparison between what has happened in Libya with Boko Haram. Boko Haram should be fought, and we all agree, because it is an extremist group that seeks to unseat a democratically elected government. Now, in Africa, we have established African response mechanism to such kind of challenges. We will be having or conducting African Amani Africa military exercise, which will take place in South Africa by the end of this week, this month, September, and beginning of October in South Africa.
Had discussions about the potential of what may have to now be done if indeed the DPRK's media reports and others prove to be true regarding their nuclear facilities at Yongbyon and the plutonium production reactor facility also near Yongbyon. So we will see what evolves. But I am convinced, I spoke again, this was one of the topics, by the way, in the conversation with Lavrov. We did not only talk about Syria, we also talked about North Korea, we talked about Ukraine and other issues. So there's a lot happening, and I can assure you that all of these countries remain fixated on the need for North Korea to denuclearize with respect to its weapons program and to live up to its international obligations. And we will continue to calibrate, as we did with Iran, by the way, the increase of particular choices that are available to us in an effort to get back to talks.
The last question goes to the South African Broadcasting Corporation, Sharon Bryce, please.
Thank you, Clayson. Madam Minister, I'll start with you. I'm sure you've seen the ruling by the full bench of the High Court in Pretoria this morning, ruling that the government acted unconstitutionally and denying the government's request to appeal that ruling, allowing Sudan's President Omar al-Bashir to leave South Africa earlier this year. The judges ruled that the government notice issued under the Diplomatic Immunities and Privileges Act basically didn't override the government's commitments made in terms of the Rome Statute. How do you react this afternoon to that ruling in South Africa? And Secretary Kerry, if I may, the State Department at the time expressed its disappointment that South Africa allowed President Bashir to leave. It urged the South African government at the time to arrest Sudan's president. But more broadly, there's an increasing number of instances and cases where the United States and South Africa differ on human rights questions, particularly certain states and certain individuals. I wonder, sir, if you could characterize the ever-evolving relationship the United States has with South Africa, particularly on the question of human rights.
Let me start with that, Shawan. We have very, very strong bilateral relations with the US. We have values and principles that we cherish. We also have a responsibility to support peace and security, which augurs well for development in the African continent and beyond. These are some of the values we share. The United States of America is not a member of the ICC. We are. So specifically on the issue of the case you are referring to, the government is busy studying the outcome, and we definitely would take the matter up at the appropriate time. Let me also just say that we both have, ourselves and the United States, embassies operating in Khartoum, because we have other responsibilities to work with them together with the South Sudan, the nascent state, for it to achieve stability and move forward in a more secure and developmental manner.
Well, let me say, look, no two countries in the world, even those that are linked together in more defined and longer term serving mutual security agreements, other kinds of agreements, are going to agree on everything, on every single instance of every case. And there are some differences. We are not a signatory. We are not a member of the ICC. Some countries hold that against us, and others understand why that position has been taken by us. But it doesn't diminish our mutual commitment to the rights of people to express themselves, to be free from unlawful imprisonment, to be tortured, to all these other things. We may have a difference in also in terms of a particular leader of a country's status with respect to issues that are more immediate and to how one country perceives they need to deal with that particular person and that country versus the options that are available to us across the Atlantic Ocean, far away from the continent, living in a different set of choices. So I don't think either of us get particularly alarmed about the reality of some of these kinds of differences that exist in many, many different places. But in no way does it detract from the fundamentals of our relationship, from the depths of our commitment to freedom, to democracy, to our people, and to the many things of which we cooperate every single day, on women and girls, on the freedom, on education, on the PEPFAR program, on security issues, on peace initiatives with respect to South Sudan, with other with Burundi, with other challenges of the region. You know, that's the mark of mature nations, and I think South Africa is exercising important leadership. We disagree here and there on a particular choice or another, but we're going to find a way to continue to see this relationship grow and blossom in its importance, and we respect and need South Africa's leadership on the continent and in the world. And that's why we're here having 3 days of a dialogue.
Thank you.
Please, thank the press you. Conference.
Yeah. We are going to go ahead and wrap on tonight's episode of Fox 10 News Now. I wish I could have brought you more tsunami coverage. Unfortunately, I lost all my feeds. We will have an update on that tomorrow, as well as maybe perhaps we'll have some footage from the debate. We could not stream it, obviously, because it's CNN. But if you're local, turn on Channel 10. If you're not local, you can head over to fox10phoenix.com and watch our live stream of our local television news broadcast. Download our app. It's free. You should follow us on Twitter, like us on Facebook. I'm seeing Danielle Miller on the screen right now. But definitely tune in to the 9 o'clock. We've also got a great 10 o'clock broadcast for you. Mark Martinez is in tonight for Troy Hayden. I always enjoy watching Mark anchor. That's why I watch him on my weekends. So go ahead and tune in to our local television broadcast if you can. Thank you so much for spending your evening with me. I will see you tomorrow.